Hello students, welcome to Don Bosco PU College online classes. We are trying our best to make teaching learning experience easy to our students. So subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to never miss any update.
Hello students, myself Abdul Wahab, Don Bosco PU College, Chizadurga. In the previous video class, I discussed the A1 biology model question paper. In that 1 marks, 2 marks, 3 marks, I discussed one by one. In this video class, I am going to continue the same A biology model question paper, A 5 marks. Okay. So, we know that a question paper consists 4 parts. A, B, C and D. A part consists 1 marks question, B part consists 2 marks question, C part consists 3 marks question. We already discussed it. Now the fourth part is D. The fourth part D is divided into two sections, section 1, section 2. Section 1, you are going to write 4-5 marks questions. In the section second, you are going to write 3-5 marks question. Let us discuss one by one. There is a one first question. Draw a neat label diagram of mature embryo sac of an angiosperms. See, the mature embryo sac is also called as a female gametophyte. This diagram carries 5 marks. So you are going to draw a neat label diagram, but must and should label the parts. So the mature embryo sac or female gametophyte consists two end. Upper end is called chalazal end and lower end is called micropylar end. In chalazal end consists three cells are there. Those cells we are called as antipodals. Then in the micropylar region we are going to see two different type of cells. One is called filiform apparatus, another called synergids. Above the synergids, we are going to see the egg cell. At the center of the embryo sac consists central cell. In that, there is a presence of two polar nuclei. In that two polar nuclei, the two pollen grains are able to fuse. Such two fusioning process is called a double fertilization. This is about the diagram of mature embryo sac. When we are move on to the next question is, explain Mendel's experiments of inheritance of one gene with reference to height nippy plant. Yes. Once again, I am going to read the question. Explain Mendel's experiment of inheritance of one gene with reference to height nippy plant. See how the question is twisted. The inheritance of one gene, nothing but a monohybrid grass. Then with reference to the height in pea plant, you are going to select only one character, that is called as a height of the plant. It is a tall and dwarf. There is no doubt this question, the answer is monohybrid grass. Let us discuss one monohybrid grass. It is defined as a monohybrid cross is a cross between two plants in relation to a pair of contrasting character. It means the two plants are there, homozygous in condition. So two homozygous plants you are going to cross. You are going to select, you are going to notice only one contrasting character. That is called as a monohybrid cross. Mono means single. So here, which is the only one character we are going to select and cross the plants, the only one contrasting character is height of the plant, height of the stem. Okay. In this experiment, a plant is nothing but garden pea plant. We are going to select. When a homozygous dominant plant is, when a homozygous dominant tall plant, such dominant tall plant consists a genotype is capital T and capital T. Such dominant genotype homozygous plant crossed with homozygous recessive dwarf plant. I already told monohybrid cross crossing between two plants. Two plants, one plant is homozygous dominant, another is homozygous recessive. In homozygous dominant, the genotype, the genes are dominant in nature. In a homozygous recessive, there is a genes are a smaller, the genes are smaller in nature. Sorry, the genes are recessive in nature. The genotype capital T, capital T in homozygous dominant plant able to control the character called tallness. In homozygous recessive plant, pea plant, the genotype small t able to regulate or control or express the dwarf character. Okay, when we are going to cross these two plants, so what will be result? When we are going to cross these, it produces the heterozygous dominant tall pea plant with a genotype capital T and small t in the first generation, that is called as a F1 generation. So when these two plants, when we are going to cross, these two plants able to produce as the A1 pea plant, that pea plant is heterozygous in condition, dominant tall in character. In that, the genes or a genotype is capital T and small t. So that is nothing but the heterozygous, two different genes we are going to see, which in next generation. So when the F1 plant, in the F1 generated plants, that is nothing but the a capital T small t heterozygous dominant tall p plant able to self cross or self pollinated to produce a three tall plants and one dwarf plant. That means in the second generation, in F2 generation, what happens, we are going to see that four plants. Among the four, three are tall in nature, one is dwarf in nature. Yes, dwarf in nature. It is called as a F2 generation. Yes. Once again, what the F1 generation plant, that is heterozygous dominant tall P plant, that is capital T small t, that is self-pollinated. In next generation, that is called the F2 generation, there is a formation or production of four plants. Among the four plants, the three are tall plant, one is a dwarf plant. Among the three tall plants, one is homozygous dominant in nature, remaining two are heterozygous dominant. Then the overall, the phenotypic ratio, there is an external appearance of monohybrid cross is nothing but a 3:1 ratio. Three are taller plants, one is dwarf plant. And genotypic ratio is 1:2, 2:1. One is होमोजेगस डोमिनेंट, टू इज हेट्रोजेगस डोमिनेंट टॉल प्लांट, वन इज रिमेनिंग वन इज होमोजेगस ड्वार्फ प्लांट. ओके, सो दिस वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी ए चक्कर बोर्ड. हाउ आर स्कीमेटिक रिप्रेजेंटेशन ನೀವು ಎಕ್ಸಾಮ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ಮಾಡ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ತಪ್ಪೇನಪ್ಪ ಅಂದರೆ ಈ ಮೊನೋಹೈಬ್ರಿಡ್ ಡೈಹೈಬ್ರಿಡ್ ಕ್ರಾಸ್ ಆಗಿರ್ಬೋದು, ಇನ್ಕಂಪ್ಲೀಟ್ ಡಾಮಿನೆನ್ಸ್ ಆಗಿರ್ಬೋದು, ನೀವು ಮಾಡ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ತಪ್ಪು ಈ ಪಾಯಿಂಟ್ಸ್ನ ಈ ಈ ಒಂದು ಕಾನ್ಸೆಪ್ಟನ್ನ ನೀವು ಬರೆಯೋಕ್ಕೆ ಹೋಗೋದಿಲ್ಲ. ನೀವೇನು ಮಾಡ್ತೀರಿ, ಡೈರೆಕ್ಟಾಗಿ ಪೇರೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ತೊಗೊಳ್ತೀರಾ, ಆ ಏನು ಕ್ರಾಸಿಂಗ್ ಪ್ರೋಸೆಸ್ನ ಬರೀತೀರಾ, ಮತ್ತು ಆ ಸ್ಕೀಮೆಟಿಕ್ ರೆಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟೇಷನ್ ಬರುತ್ತೆ, ಚಕ್ರ ಬೋರ್ಡ್ ಹಾಕ್ತೀರಾ, ನನಗೆ ಮಾರ್ಕ್ಸ್ ಬಂದಿಲ್ಲ ಅಂತೀರಾ, ತಪ್ಪು. ಸೊ ಈ ಪಾಯಿಂಟ್ಸ್ ಬರೆದು ಆದಮೇಲೆ ಚಕ್ಕರ್ ಬೋರ್ಡ್ ಹಾಕಿ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ಲೇನ್ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು. ಓಕೆನಾ, ನೋಡಿ ದಿಸ್ ಈಸ್ ಎ ಸ್ಕಿಮ್ಯಾಟಿಕ್ ರೆಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟೇಷನ್. ನಾನು ಆವಾಗಲೇ ಹೇಳ್ದಂಗೆ ದ ಪೇರೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ವಿಚ್ ಆರ್ ದ ಟೂ ಪೇರೆಂಟ್ಸ್, ಒನ್ ಈಸ್ ದ ಟಾಲ್, ಅನದರ್ ಈಸ್ ದ ಥಿಂಗ್ ಬಟ್ ಡ್ವಾರ್ಫ್. ಎಸ್, ದ ಟೂ ಹೋಮೋಜೆಗಸ್ ಪ್ಲಾಂಟ್ಸ್, ಒನ್ ಈಸ್ ದ ಟಾಲ್, ಅನದರ್ ಇಸ್ ಅ ಡ್ವಾರ್ಫ್. ದ ಟಾಲ್ನೆಸ್ ಕ್ಯಾರೆಕ್ಟರ್ ಕಂಟ್ರೋಲ್ ಬೈ ಟೂ ಜೀನ್ಸ್, ಕ್ಯಾಪಿಟಲ್ ಟಿ, ದೀಸ್ ಆರ್ ದ ಡಾಮಿನೆಂಟ್ ಜೀನ್ಸ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಡ್ವಾರ್ಫ್, ದ ಡ್ವಾರ್ಫ್ನೆಸ್ ಈಸ್ ಕಂಟ್ರೋಲ್ ಬೈ ಎ ಟೂ ಜೀನ್ಸ್ ಕಾಲ್ಡ್ ಸ್ಮಾಲ್ ಟಿ. ಸೊ ಫ್ರಮ್ ದ ಒನ್ ಹೋಮೋಜೆಗಸ್ ಪೇರೆಂಟ್ ದರ್ ಇಸ್ ಎ ಒನ್ ಗೇಮಿಟ್ ಕ್ಯಾಪಿಟಲ್ ಟಿ ಈಸ್ ಫಾರಮ್, ಒನ್ ಜೀನ್ ಈಸ್ ಫಾರಮ್, ಅನದರ್ ಈಸ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಫ್ರಮ್ ದ ಡ್ವಾರ್ಫ್ ಸ್ಮಾಲ್ ಟಿ ಈಸ್ ಕಮ್ಸ್. The gene, these two genes are comes through the gametes. When these two are fused together in the F1 generation, we are going to see the heterozygous dominant tall. Such heterozygous dominant tall is self-crossed, self-pollinated. So we are going to see the F2 generation. See, capital T, small t, capital T, small t. Okay. Capital T from the one heterozygous dominant, the two gametes will become, see, in the upper row capital T small t, in lower row small t capital T. Both, one is among them two, one is male, another is the female. The capital T capital T, these two genes from the gametes able to fuse, the dominant tall will be forms. And then capital T, small t, these two, we are going to, there is a fuse, there is a heterozygous tall we are going to see. The capital T, tall is nothing but the homozygous. Capital T, small t is a heterozygous, and capital T, small t is a tall, nothing but the heterozygous tall, and small t, small, nothing but the dwarfness. Finally, the phenotypic ratio is 3:1, and genotypic ratio is the 1:2:1. Next, the question is, draw a neat label diagram of sectional view of mammary gland. In the class, I repeatedly told either male reproductive system, female reproductive system, or a mammary gland. Among the three, anyone will be appear for 5 marks as a diagrammatic. So, you have to practice well. See, here the mammary gland. You have to draw the label diagram and label the parts. Each labeling carries the half marks. You are going to label the 10 labels, you are going to get the 5 marks. Okay, so this is the diagrammatic view of mammary gland. We'll move on to the next question. Is list the salient features of human genome. So you are going to write the features of human genome. So the first one is, the human genome contains a 3,164.7 million nucleotide bases. How much? The human genome contains 3,164.7 million nucleotide bases are there. Then, the average gene consists of 3000 bases. But one thing, its size may vary. Okay, vary. Then the largest non-human genome is the thing about the dystrophin. It is about the bases or nitrogenous bases, nucleoside bases are 2.4 billion million bases. The second character is the total number of genes is estimated the 330,000. Okay, 30,000. Then the previously estimate the 80,000 to 140,000 genes. Almost all 99.9% nucleotide bases are exactly same in all the peoples. In all the peoples. Zoom meeting ನಾನು ಕಾಲ್ ಮಾಡಿದಾಗ ಕೆಲವರು ಕೇಳಿದ್ರು ಯಾರು ಇದ್ರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಕ್ಯಾರೆಕ್ಟರ್ಸ್ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರು ಅಂತೇಳಿ. ಸಿ ವಾಟ್ ದ ಜೀನ್ ವಿಚ್ ಕನ್ಸಿಸ್ಟ್ ದ ಎ ನ್ಯೂಕ್ಲಿಯೋಟೈಡ್ ಬೇಸಸ್ ಇನ್ ಆಲ್ ದ ಹ್ಯೂಮನ್ ಬೀಯಿಂಗ್ ಇನ್ ಆಲ್ ದ ಪೀಪಲ್ಸ್ 99.9% ಆರ್ ಸೇಮ್ ಓನ್ಲಿ 0.1% ಈಸ್ ಡಿಫ್ರೆಂಟ್ ಸಚ್ ಡಿಫ್ರೆನ್ಸ್ ಯು ಆರ್ ಗೋಯಿಂಗ್ ಟು ಸಿ ಅಮಂಗ್ ದಿಮ್ ಸರ್ ನಮ್ಮಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಒಬ್ರಿಗೊಬ್ರು ನೋಡ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥದ್ದು. Then the next feature is the function of unknown over 50% of discovered genes. Unknown genes we are going to discover 50%. Less than 2% of the genome codes the proteins. Codes for the protein. So only less than 2% of genes are able to code the protein molecules. The repeated sequence make up very large portion of the human genome. Then the repetitive sequences are stretches of DNA sequences that are repeated many times, sometimes 100 to 1000 times. So here the repeated sequence may make up large portion, and those repeated sequences are stretches in DNA sequences in many repeated times. Okay, they are thought to have no direct coding function, but they are shed light on chromosome structure, dynamics and evolution. Okay, the last character is chromosome 1. Most genes, nothing but, so 2968, and why has the lowest genes we are going to see. See, there are 46 chromosomes. When you are going to count 1, 2, 3, 4, the first chromosome consists most of the genes, I think, but the 2968, and the Y, the male sex chromosome, has the fewest, nothing but the 231 genes we are going to see. These are the different features of human genome. We are moving on to the next question is, explain the regulation of lac operon in the absence and presence of lactose in the medium. Nothing but the a lac operon concept. Na il salpa twist mat kelana aste. Nothing but the lac operon concept. Lactose switch off switch on concept na mechanism na kelta hogtane adana in absence of lactose presence of lactose yenen agut nortta hogtane kelta hogtane. Let us discuss one by one. First of all, in the absence of lactose, what the changes or mechanism is taken place in the absence of lactose? The three repressor protein induced from lac I gene binds to operator region, preventing RNA polymerase enzyme to bind to promoter region and switch off the transcription of the three structural genes like LacZ, lactose Z, lactose Y, lactose A that encodes for the respective enzyme. So these are the a process is taken place during the or in absence of lactose. What? The three repressor gene proteins produced from lac I gene. Okay, these three proteins binds the operator gene, operator region, sorry. So when the three repressor protein able to bind the operator region, here there is a RNA polymerase able to prevent to, or the RNA polymerase able did not able to bind the promoter region, then the transcription process is switch off. Then the three structural genes lac Z, lac Y, lac A that encodes for the respective enzymes. Okay, in the presence of lactose, the repressor protein, the three repressor protein produced from the lac I gene binds to the lactose, forming a repressor inducer complex that cannot bind the operator gene. Once again, then in the presence of lactose, what happened? The repressor gene able to binds the lactose. The repressor protein able to binds the lactose and forming the a complex called repressor inducer complex that cannot bind to the any operator region. Then the promoter region is free. Then the polymer enzyme able to binds the three structural genes. Then the transcription process is taken place. Finally, the three structural genes are able to code for the respective enzyme. So this concept we are going to study in this schematic representation. Okay, here in presence of inducer, nothing but the lactose. Okay, lactose. So here one thing is, see, there is a Z, Y, A lac genes are there. Then what happens? The repressor binds the operator region and prevents the RNA polymerase transcription the operon. This is nothing but the promoter region. So in this diagram, we are going to know how the lactose during the absence and presence switch off or switch on the transcription process. Next, move on to the question called as, what are methods to introduce alien DNA or foreign DNA into the host cell? Here the 32 question is split into two. One is 3 marks, another is the 2 marks. The 3 marks question, nothing but the what are the methods to introduce alien DNA into the host cell. The three methods are microinjection, then microinjection, biolistic or gene gun, then third one is the plasmid vector. Yes, first microinjection, nothing but a process of direct transformation of rDNA into the nucleus of animal cell by micro syringes. We know that. Second method is biolistic or gene gun. It is a method used in the plants where the plant cells are bombarded with the high velocity of microparticles of gold or tungsten coated with DNA. Third one is the plasmid vectors and disarmed pathogenic vectors. Okay, TI plasmid or retroviruses. When these are allowed to infect the cell, transfer the rDNA into the host. But basically, the methods nothing but the microinjection, biolistics, or gene gun, finally, plasmid vectors. The second question in that is, write any two tools used in recombinant DNA technology. So, tools nothing but the enzymes are there, vector DNA are there, host organisms are there, bioreactors. These are all tools. Okay, in sections. In this, the section second part D is completed. Next, we are move on to the section 2. Yes. In the section 2, 33 question is, here also the question is split. Where are the opioid receptors located in human body? This carries tumors. So, generally, one location is central nervous system. That is brain. CNS. Second is a gastrointestinal tract, nothing but the digestive system. Second question, mention the techniques involved in cancer detection and diagnosis. The techniques are, one is biopsy test. Okay, so which part is undergo cancer, that part we are going to study the biopsy, that is histopathological test. Second is a radiography using the X-rays. Okay. Then third, CT scan, computed tomography or computer tomography. So, see what the COVID is there, a virus. In India, now there is a second mutant, there is a second wave, that is nothing but the one mutant is affected, causes. But in ICPTR, in test, the corona patients will not show the any positiveness. But such corona patient is undergo CT scan, then only it shows a positiveness. Okay. The CT scan gives the exact result. So fourth one is the MRI, magnetic resonance imaging. These are the four detection diagnosis of cancer. Next, explain briefly the uses of transgenic animals. Uses of the transgenic animals. One, explain the uses of transgenic animals. The first thing is nothing but the gene regulation and its effects on normal function of the body and its development. From this study, the example nothing but the insulin link growth factor. Okay, insulin link growth factor. The second study is nothing but the study of diseases. The transgenic animals models are used to understand that contribution of genes and development of the disease and investigate new treatments for disease like fibrosis, rheumatoid arthritis and Alzheimer's disease. Okay, here the transgenic animals are very useful in study of diseases. The transgenic animals are used as a model animals to understand the development of disease, investigate the new treatments, those diseases like fibrosis or rheumatoid arthritis or Alzheimer's disease, etc. See, the next one is the biological products. The transgenic animals are used to producing the pharmaceutical products, nothing but the medicinal products to treat the to various diseases like for example, transgenic cattle created to produce the milk containing a human protein called as antitrypsin, which may help in treatment of human emphysema. Okay, human emphysema treatment madlike ee protein is bartakkantadu. For example, Rosie is the first transgenic cow in 1997 that produced the milk enriched with human protein lactoalbumin, which is nutritionally more balanced product for the human babies than natural cow milk. The one more use of transgenic animals nothing but the vaccine safety. For example, transgenic mice are being developed for use in testing for the safety of vaccines like polio vaccines before they are directly used to any human being. Finally, the chemical safety testing. The transgenic animals are exposed to toxic substances to study their effects in less time. Okay, next, move on to the 35th question. Mention the possible genotypes of blood group A and B. Here the question is split. This question carries the tumors. The possible genotype of blood group A is Ia, Ia and Ia small I, and B is capital IB, capital IB and capital IB small I. These are the possible genotypes. Next, explain briefly the sex determination in honeybees. In honeybees. So, in honeybee, the male is haploid with 16 chromosomes, haploid in nature. The female is diploid in nature. See, male is a haploid, female is the diploid. The male haploid contains 16 chromosome and diploid female contains 32 chromosome. Male produces the sperm by mitosis, female produces the ova by meiosis. The male offsprings are formed from the union of sperm and egg. The female offsprings are formed from the union of sperm and egg. Female, one thing is clear, when the sperm and egg the sexual reproduction is taken place, then only the females are formed, that is called as a queen. But the males' offsprings are formed from unfertilized egg. When the sperm is able to fuse, the fertilization is there. From the fertilization, the females are formed. When the sperm and egg able to unfertilized, from that egg the males drones are able to form. That process is called as a parthenogenesis. Okay, then discuss the role of microbes as biofertilizers. Biofertilizers. So which are the microbes are helpful for the biofertilizers? We know that biofertilizers, the organism which are helpful to enrich the soil fertility, it is called as biofertilizers. The main biofertilizer sources are bacteria, fungi, cyanobacteria, because these are enrich the soil quality or nutrient quality. Okay, first is rhizobium bacteria. It is a symbiotic bacteria. It is able to lead a life in the root nodules of legumes. Its function is to fix the free nitrogen okay. Then the free living nitrogen fixing bacteria like Azospirillum and Azotobacter, these are enrich the nitrogen content of the soil. Then the cyanobacteria like Nostoc, Anabina, Oscillatoria, these are live freely or a symbiotic association which can fix the atmospheric nitrogen. Okay, specialized heterocyst cells enrich the nitrogen content of the soil. Then next group is fungi. Fungi form symbiotic association with the roots of higher plants like a mycorrhiza, for example many members of genus Glomus. These fungus, symbiotic fungus, are able to absorb the phosphorus from the soil and show resistance to root borne pathogens and tolerance to the salinity. The last is question, what is commensalism? Mention any four interactions of organisms that represent the commensalism. Illi nalakku examples na tagondo how the commensalism is there, how the animals are interacted, that we are going to discuss. One is commensalism means relationship between two living individuals, two living organisms, different species of different species, in which one is benefited while other is neither harmed nor benefited. Illi the two animals, the two species are, the two different species are able to lead together. One is totally benefited, other one is either be benefited nor be harmed. So the first example is epiphytes on other plants. The plant growing, the epiphytic plant growing on other plant get benefit by using the other plant as habitat, but do not harm. The other plant is neither benefited nor harmed. Epiphyte plant and mothe inan plant mele grow agutte, but inan plant mele grow agbitte agutte other habitat neither acquire madutte, idu benefit agutte. But yad mele what the another plant is there, it will not get any type of the benefit or harmness. Next, sea anemone on a hermit crab is the second example. Sea anemone gets benefit by protecting itself from the predator but do not harm hermit crab. Enagutte sea anemone on hermit crab, hermit crab nal hobittu sea anemone irthakkantadu. Sea anemone en madutte protection tonta hogutte predators inda, elli hermit crab nal hogsirkanbitte. But this sea anemone will not able to give any type of the benefit or it not give any type of the harmness. Then next example, cattle aggregate and grazing cattle. Grazing cattle, cattle aggregate birds gets pick the insects on the cattles. From that the cattles are able cattles aggregate birds are able to graze, are able to get the food. The cattles neither benefited nor be harmed. Then the suckerfish and whale. Suckerfish is attaches to the adhere to the whale. The suckerfish able to get the protection from the predators and able to get the food what the whale remains. But the sucker fish get the benefit. The whale will not get the any benefit or not get any type of the harmness. So this is about the a commensalism. In this, a one model question paper is completed. Okay. In the next video class, we are going to discuss another model question paper. Thank you.